Goedendag. Dit is Kleurnet, mijn naam is Luc Sala en dit is het programma onderdeel Spirit 2000. Dat zijn programma's, interviews, gesprekken over spiritualiteit, over filosofie, over onderwerpen die wat verder gaan dan de dagelijkse praktijk. Vandaag gaan we praten met Carolyn Lee. Ze heeft een boek geschreven over Adida. Dat is een Amerikaanse verlichte geest. Een man die heel veel boeken geschreven heeft. Misschien heeft u wel eens wat in een boekwinkel gelezen van Daffy John. Dat was een van de namen die hij heeft gebruikt. Maar hij wijzigt zijn naam nogal eens. En hij heeft een grote schare volgelingen. En er worden over de hele wereld workshops gegeven. Ook in Amsterdam. Onder andere op het Oosterpark 39. En ik geef even het nummer 020-468-1442. Dat is de organisatie. We praten met Carolyn over haar boek. Dat gaat over haar ervaringen met deze Godman. Want het boek heet The Promised Godman is Here. The Godmens is here. Welcome, Carolyn.
Thank you, Luke.
Okay, so you wrote this book about a man that you've known for how long?
Since 1985. Not personally since 1985, but I found out about him and became his student in 1985. And then I began to have much more human contact with him around 1994.
Yeah. I understand that the teaching of Adida is much about relationship that you have as a devotee, mm-hmm. as a student, as a follower to mm-hmm. him.
That's
and that
right.
Part of his approach is that by you eliminating the separation between you and him, mm-hmm. you come in better contact with the wider Godhead.
Right. Well, that has been my experience. In fact, it's an interesting thing to tell you, but the very first time that I saw him, I was in Holland. This was back in 1986, and I, and along with another about 100 of his new devotees from England and from Holland, were invited to see him in a place called Mariahope in the south of Holland. It was an ex-monastery, a big, old, rambling building, and we sat there with him in silence on one occasion, and on a second occasion he talked with us, and I had the most extraordinary experience of my life on those 2 days.
Well, now we're in Amsterdam here. Lots of people smoke a joint or take a tablet and they have a high experience.
Yeah.
They get high.
Yeah.
Is it comparable with that?
Well, that's an interesting question. Now, I had never done that, so I didn't have anything to compare it to. But I can tell you that when I sat in the room with Adida Samraj, well, several things happened. First of all, I felt this incredible pressure on my heart, which was a love pressure, like an almost intolerable sense of being in love. And at the same time, I was looking at him across the room, and what I saw astounded my eyes, because it wasn't just a human body, which it obviously was. There was so much light streaming from his body. And it wasn't just like switching on a light. It was a feeling light. It was a light that carried love.
Would you say it was a physical experience?
It was a fully physical experience, and it was a deeply feeling or emotional experience at the same time. But it wasn't happening in my head like a drug experience. It wasn't happening within my brain. It was happening over there in the room, and it was coming towards me as in one sense, but at the same time, my whole body was full of it. Mm-hmm. It was enveloping me.
But isn't the theory not that energy, that love, is there all the time, not only from Adida, but from the whole world?
Absolutely.
Or from whatever, and that we are only unable to see it, and that we don't have the cameras or the equipment to prove that it's there, but seemingly many mystics tell us that it's there all the time.
Well, he says that it's there all the time, and one way that he could be described is like a window to what is there all the time. But the force of his love and presence is so strong that it actually penetrates the fact that we're closed to it most of the time. It like opens us up, you could say like a flower. That's how it felt. It was like opening like a flower to the love and bliss and warmth of the sun, mm-hmm. the divine sun, that is there all the time.
If you would give that a color, what color would you give it?
Well, in my case, it was gold and white. But some people see other colors, all kinds of colors. It's very individual, mm-hmm. what you see. But the thing that I was so astounded by was that I had never had these kinds of experiences. I was just an ordinary person who wasn't even interested in having.
But did you notice, have you seen other teachers or enlightened people in your life?
I've seen them on TV. I haven't seen them personally.
Well, I've seen a lot of them, and Andrew Cohen, which I also interviewed. At some time, I had this same gold experience, and with what's the guy from the TM movement?
Maharishi.
Maharishi Mahesh Yogi. I had a one-on-one session with him, and I had to stop. I said, "Sir, I don't know what's happening here, but there's this very strange, exactly as you describe." And he was really powerful. I mean, there was gold there, and it was unbelievable, really. I stopped listening to what he said, and later understood that it wasn't necessary. He was kind of babbling his usual natural law stuff, which I've heard many times before and I've read many times. But there was something there in a transfer of energy.
Well, this is the very important matter, this matter of spiritual transmission, which I hadn't experienced. I'd been brought up as a Christian, and I'd heard about the Holy Spirit.
Well, if you read the Christian books, they have the little halos.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
You think they invented it all?
Well, I knew they hadn't, but I knew that I wasn't experiencing it in my growing up years in Christianity, and I didn't meet anyone who had. So now I know that spiritual transmission is real. It's an actual fact. And great beings have transmitted this force of God, and I, over 15 years of knowing Adida Samraj, have experienced that to an absolutely overwhelming degree. It feels like it's changed my cells. You know,
you've written a book about it, not only about your own experience, but you've interviewed other devotees.
Right.
Is that a good word, devotee? I mean, that's what you would say.
Well, this is the word that we use, because it indicates the nature of the relationship. That it's
isn't
love.
That limiting? I mean, how do you make a living? Yeah, well, you write books, but how do you make a living, for instance?
Well, I live at Adida's hermitage in Fiji. I'm traveling now for a few months, but for the last number of years, I've lived there. And it is a sanctuary where you're simply living a life where you're supported simply to do the spiritual practice and to serve other people through all these means, such as writing books. And so forth.
But there are people in the normal world who would say, all these lunatics, all these new agers, they're escapist. They escape from the world. They go sit in some place and let the world provide for them or their parents, whatever. And we, of course, have a whole Osho movement seeing that where the chief or the enlightened one gets a lot of gifts. There's a rather a feeling that this is an escape from reality of work and responsibility.
Well, I think that there's always been a need. It doesn't matter what religious movement that you look at. If it's really serious, there have to be some people who devote themselves full time to deep study of their teachings, of the teachings of their tradition, to prayer, to contemplation. And some of them may very well go out and spend years in the world. That's true in many Catholic orders, and I know it's been true in India.
But there's also the contemplative orders who say, Our prayer is important for the world, peace or whatever is needed.
That is the other thing. I mean, European civilization, a lot of it was created by the studies and the art that arose out of these communities of people that devoted themselves to prayer. And then the people in the world with the money, with the power, they gave the money to allow all of that to take concrete form in churches, in great works of art and so forth.
Yeah,
so it's
Europe
a very mutual
it's littered
matter.
With hermitage and monasteries that do that.
And that's true culture. That's true civilization, where you allow people to devote themselves to
these. Do you think that in the old days, and when we talk about these halos, the first time they showed up was is in Greek paintings. So it's the Christian church and the painters from the early Christian era kind of borrowed that from the Greeks. So it's not... And we know from other situations, the Tibetan, the Bon, you know, before the Buddhism, that there was always this idea about light and fire and auras. So that's not new. But do you think in the old days people were able to see that more easily?
It may be, because more people were really valued such a thing. I think more people really valued the spiritual practice that can lead you to become sensitive to that. And I think that one of the most important things that's happening now in the world at the turn of this millennium is that more people are realizing we have to do this, that access to spiritual transmission and God consciousness is essential for the sanity of humanity.
Why? Wait a moment. The world is in an economic upturn. We are rich. This week we heard there was a mega merger of, I don't know, hundreds of billions of dollars. The money is flowing. Why do we need God?
Well, what had we witnessed in Europe in the last few months? The Kosovo war? Look at what was going on there.
Yeah, there were some earthquakes, but you know, that's maybe that's right. Inevitable. Why would modern man or woman go and search for God, either in a person like Adida or Osho or whatever Indian sage or Western preacher? Why would we go look for God? Why is it so essential?
Because of death. It's always been the reason for religion. The terrible suffering of the fact that we live, we love, and then we die. And everything we know and love dies too.
Yeah, but then you say we only should look for God out of fear. Fear for death, fear for sickness, whatever.
I would say that is one reason that many, many people look for God. And the interesting thing is that in my own case, until I met Adi Da, I realized that I had been involved in religion to a great deal, to a great extent, because of fear. And what happened when I came
in
contact...
If you don't follow our rites or whatever, oh, you'll die, a sinner.
That's right. Yeah. You'll go to hell. You don't want that, so you'd better toe the line and practice this religion and keep the moral laws and so on. But what I found when I came in contact with him was that love became the reason for religion. The in-love relationship with him. Mm-hmm. And that was God to me. That was everything that I had imagined could be ever possible and far, far more.
Yeah. But true Christian and with true someone who really believes that, like Brother David Stanley Rustel, would say, yes, but 2,000 years ago there was a man like Adi Da or Buddha, and his name was Jesus Christ, or Joshua ben Yosef, and he had that. Why do we need new holy men? Why do we need new enlightened people like this Adi Da?
Because all of those men have gone, and women, by the way, they are dead in the body anyway. They're not present in the body.
And you say we need the presence to come to this realization.
It's been my experience that having this revelation come so powerfully in the form of a living human being has transformed religion for me. It's transformed my life. It's transformed my sense of what all of religious history has been about, to be completely honest with you, Luke.
Do you not understand religious history, like from what these guys did and the miracles they did?
But do we see that
Anthony out there in the desert and praying and meeting the devil?
Yes, right. Well, that was all going on inside of him in the course of his deep spiritual struggle with himself. And he was the one who was the master of other monks who were living out there too. Who was his master? It was Jesus, and he communed with him. But Jesus wasn't there saying, Anthony, do this, do that. Relate to me in this new way. He only could work on what he could feel in relation to Jesus through prayer. He didn't have Jesus in front of him kicking his ass, as Adi Da has sometimes said in colloquial New York language. You need me to kick your ass, to show you what you're up to in ways that you will never find out if you are merely
That's true.
Just
and many
praying.
People need that, and other people don't need it. They read Kabir, or then they read the Bible and they say, this is the living word of God coming to me. I mean, there's many ways to find things. What is important is the feeling of separation, that we should stop feeling separate from the outside, because the outside is us, and this is an eternal truth that I think Adi Da preaches and lives.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, thank you, Carolyn. The book is called The Promised God is Here.
The Promised God-Man.
God-Man, like Jesus. God-Man. The Promised God-Man is here. And you can get it at Oosterpark 39 024 68 1442. Thank you.
Thank you.